good to go? How about that? Good. Well, hello, everyone. My name is Bernard Siegel. I'm the executive director of the Regenerative Medicine Foundation. My organization is the producer of the World Stem Cell Summit. We are delighted that you are part of the public day and understand that the sessions from the Grand Ballroom are being seen all over the world, live streamed. We hope you're going to enjoy yourself while you're in Palm Beach, and we're certainly happy to host you. Now, this particular panel is going to take you to off the planet. One of our co-organizers this year is the Center for Advancement of Science in Space. Many people do not realize that what is going on the International Space Station, the science of microgravity in cells, is a game changer in an enormous way. Some of the research has spawned one of the great new commercial enterprises, zero gravity solutions. And you have around your neck, on your lanyard, zero gravity solutions. You'll be able to hear of a case study later on in the main summit. But for now, what we are going to be presenting in this session is the mind-bending science that's going on in space, how it's going to impact the field of cell biology and stem cells. We're even going to Skype, and we're going to meet one of the exciting astronauts that's part of NASA and the space program. Chairing this session is Liz Warren. Dr. Warren is the Associate Program Manager of the Center for Advancement of Science in Space. Let's welcome her and the CASES team. Thank you.
Thanks, Bernie. Well, we have a very exciting day to do today. Thank you all for joining us this morning at the World Stem Cell Summit. As Bernie said, my name is Liz Warren. I work for the Center for the Advancement of Science in Space, CASES. You'll be hearing from us later on today. We have a simulated mission to the International Space Station. We've got a panel on Thursday as well. So Center for the Advancement of Science in Space, that may not mean a whole lot to this audience, so let me tell you briefly what our organization does. First of all, we have an amazing laboratory in space. It's orbiting about 250 miles up right now. It took several years to build and a lot of effort, a lot of launches right out of Cape Canaveral up the road here. And this laboratory in space is called the International Space Station. It goes around the entire planet every 90 minutes, and it is a truly world-class, off-the-world laboratory where some incredible research is taking place. As CASES, we are responsible for the U.S. National Laboratory on the International Space Station. We're responsible for selecting and manifesting science ranging from life sciences, materials, and physical sciences, consumer product development, Earth observation, STEM education, and technology development. We're responsible for about 50% of the research allocation and crew time on the International Space Station, as well as 50% of the available up mass and down mass. That's bringing research and samples to the space station and bringing them back to Earth. The biggest difference between CASES and NASA, who are our partners in this endeavor, is that our research team selects research and manifests research to the space station. It must have an Earth-facing benefit. It must benefit all of us here on Earth. So a lot of NASA's missions are intended to keep humans productive in space longer, and they're really exploration-related goals. Our goals are bringing benefits from that microgravity research back down here on Earth. So for this audience, how can microgravity impact life sciences or stem cell research to improve human health here on Earth? How can we better understand disease or develop better, more potent therapeutics to improve our way of life? And how can microgravity help to unlock some of those secrets that maybe aren't even possible in laboratories here on Earth? which is why this panel is a great way to introduce you to what is possible through microgravity inquiry on board the International Space Station. And honestly, we have really a great treat for you this morning. We have two brilliant scientists here to tell their story and talk about the research that they sent to the International Space Station. And we have the actual astronaut who conducted their research on board the International Space Station to join our conversation. So that's enough introduction. Let me get to our guests here. I'd like to introduce Arun Sharma, furthest to your right, formerly of Stanford University's Cardiovascular Institute, and is now a research fellow at Harvard University. And Dr. Peter Lee, to my immediate left, from The Ohio State University. They were both co-investigators on a recent, very recent, space station experiment focused on the effects of microgravity on stem cell-derived cardiomyocytes, or heart cells. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce, joining us remotely from Houston, Texas, NASA astronaut and biologist, microbiologist, and virologist extraordinaire, Dr. Kate Rubins. So Kate can't see us, but we can see her. Fantastic. So this is what we're looking to do this morning. I have a series of questions for the panel. We'll tell you all about their investigation in stem cells research in space, and then we might have some time for questions and answers at the end. Does that work for everybody? Excellent. Well, let's go. Kate, let's start with you. Welcome back to Earth. You landed on October 29th, so just about a month ago, after 115 days in space, living and working aboard the International Space Station. Can you tell us a little bit about your mission and what your daily schedule looked like?
Absolutely. It's great to be back on the planet with all of you guys. We were living off-world for quite some time, and it's as Liz said, it's really an incredible laboratory. So a lot of the day is actually devoted to scientific experiments on board. We performed over 275 different science experiments. One of the more interesting ones, I think, was the cell culture experiment. So in this experiment, we were really able to grow cells in culture for the first time for a really long duration aboard the International Space Station. Of course, your day up there involves a lot of other things, looking at the Earth, taking photos, physics experiments, fluidics experiments, and of course we have to fix the toilet and maintain the space station as well.
Awesome. And for this audience that may not be aware, living in space while it looks like a lot of fun to float around in microgravity, it's actually not that great for the human body. Some of the effects include muscle loss, bone mass loss, cardiovascular deconditioning, and so that brings me to my question, my first question for Peter. You're a cardiothoracic surgeon with an interest in astronaut heart health. Can you tell us about how astronauts cardiovascular deconditioning is similar to cardiovascular issues here on Earth?
Sure, absolutely, and thanks for that great introduction. So as many of you may know, a lot of what happens in space affects the human body, and most systems in the human body are affected one way or another, and it's usually detrimental. Things that we are most commonly aware of are, as already mentioned, muscle loss, bone loss, but changes to the vestibular system and the cardiovascular system certainly is not immune. And it appears when you see the changes that happen to the human body, it mimics what you typically see with aging. And so it almost seems like an accelerated aging process. And that's interesting for several reasons, but one is that we study what happens in space in a short period of time. We may be able to get some information and understand what happens with the aging process, which takes obviously a lot longer. And so there are applications to that research for here on Earth. For the cardiovascular system, we know that there's not only a shift in the body fluid, so there's a shift of fluid from the lower legs more up to the head, which has a lot of impact to the whole cardiovascular system and how much blood volume there is, which overall goes down. There is, we know that the heart function appears to be affected. There appears to be some degree of muscle atrophy or decrease in muscle mass. And also the control systems for the heart, the neurological control systems appear to be impacted negatively. And there's also, at least incidentally, there's an increase in arrhythmias or irregular heart rhythms. And so, fortunately, till now, you know, the astronauts that go into space are generally relatively young, they're very healthy, and so, and they have time to exercise and do countermeasures to help prevent some of the changes. But in the future, we're looking at very long duration space flights, so more than just the 6 months, looking at possibly a couple of years. And then we're also looking at, with space tourism in the forefront, individuals who are a little bit older, less healthy, going into space, and we don't know what kind of effects those will have. And so understanding how these changes impact the heart are going to be very important. And some of these changes we also will be able to correlate with cardiovascular disease on Earth. And so that's what we're looking at.
Right. So a lot of exercise is done in the daily lives of astronauts to, like you said, to help prevent or mitigate some of that cardiovascular deconditioning. So is that what led you to the heart cells investigation, to proposing this research to occur?
Yes, so I've had an interest in space-related research for many years, even before I decided to go to med school and pursue the PhD and do research as well. And as I gradually got into my clinical field, which is primarily cardiac surgeries, I do heart surgeries and I do heart transplants, obviously my focus started going towards the cardiovascular system and the heart. And the heart hasn't been studied as much as muscle, skeletal muscle and bone in the past, because it wasn't as big of an issue for the shuttle era when they were in space for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. But now we're realizing, as we look at longer duration, we're looking at the effect of radiation. As we think about going to Mars, the heart is now much more vulnerable and we need to better understand it. So we're at a point now where it's really important to get beyond where we've been able to study the heart. And now we also have technology that allows us to study the heart cells that 5-10 years ago was not really possible.
That's awesome. So Arun, tell us more about how you arrived at this heart cells investigation and your involvement. And if you would, tell us about some of the implications or applications of using the induced pluripotent stem cell-derived cardiomyocytes to study cardiovascular biology.
Sure. So as Peter mentioned, until now, we haven't had a really good model system, a model cellular system with which we can study cardiac function. And so that's where the induced pluripotent stem cells, or iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes, came into play. These iPSCs, as a lot of us know, we can derive them from a small sample of a person's own skin or white blood cells over a process that takes about 1 month. And after that 1 month long procedure, you get pluripotent stem cells which can transform into pretty much whatever cell type you're interested in, whether it's a neuron, a skin cell, and since we're cardiovascular researchers, we're interested in cardiomyocytes or heart cells. And so there are thought to be three major applications for these iPS-derived cardiomyocytes. The first application is using these cells as a platform to screen pharmacological compounds, screen compounds that are under development by drug companies. To give an example, some of these compounds can have off-target cardiotoxic side effects. And this iPS-derived cardiomyocyte system allows us to have a platform with which we can screen some of these toxic side effects. Another application of iPS-derived cardiomyocytes is potentially for the purposes of cell therapy. So for example, during a heart attack, you actually lose a substantial portion of the cardiomyocytes, the heart cells in your heart. And the heart is actually a really unique organ because those heart cells that are lost during a heart attack usually don't come back. It's very difficult for the heart to regenerate itself. And so we're thinking that we might be able to utilize a different cell source with which we can replace those lost cells in the heart. And that's where the iPS cardiomyocytes come into play. And the third application, which is kind of what we were doing here, is using these iPS-derived heart cells, these cardiomyocytes, as a model system, a system with which we can model disease or model physiological function. To give an example, if there's a patient who has a genetic abnormality causing an irregularity in a heartbeat, that same patient's iPS-derived cardiomyocytes will exhibit the same irregularities. So you can model those arrhythmias, those heart rhythm problems, using cells derived from the patient, these iPS-derived cardiomyocytes. And in a way, that's what we were trying to do here. We were trying to use iPS-derived cardiomyocytes to model the effect of microgravity on heart function. We've been able to look at heart function on the organ level, but it hasn't really been well understood in terms of the effects of microgravity on the cellular level. And that's why these cells are very important and why this is a very useful system. So what we were doing was we derived iPS-derived cardiomyocytes from three separate individuals and sent these cells to the International Space Station, where they were cultured for about 1 month by Kate Rubins, who's joining us here today. And on orbit, Kate was examining these cells for changes that may have occurred in response to microgravity, whether it's changes in cell shape, size, beating ability, and also gene expression, changes in genetics. That's also something that we looked at. And so she was able to replace the nutrients on these cells on a weekly basis for 1 month, and then return a sample of cells live back to our laboratory at Stanford University, and we're still in the process of doing some additional analysis on that.
Well, that's fantastic. Something that you mentioned is we have a variety of ways of looking at cardiovascular health on the space station, and in fact, earlier this morning, Dr. Rubins was getting a post-flight medical exam, actually collecting data to look at part of her cardiovascular system using ultrasound. And there's actually an ultrasound on board the International Space Station as well. And it appears there's actually been a fire alarm over at NASA. So Kate will be back with us when the fire alarm is over. But this actually brings us to an interesting point. For both Peter and Arun, it's a little unusual as a scientist for you to not be hands-on with an experiment that is occurring. You know, it's not in your lab, it's in a lab that's only 250 miles away, but it's pretty far out of reach because it's in space. So tell us about some of the challenges and tell us about translating your experiment from your lab bench to space. It's probably a little not as intuitive as one might imagine.
Yes, absolutely. Doing research in space is certainly a lot more complex and more expensive. And it takes a lot more planning, for sure. I've had the privilege of having done other spaceflight experiments back in the shuttle days and also in zero-g parabolic flights and a self-contained fruit fly experiment about two years ago on the space station. And one of the things that I've learned early on is that the way you think about planning and setting up an experiment is completely different. You know, the essentials of coming up with a hypothesis and the design of the experiment and the analysis and all that doesn't change, but how you set up the experiment and how it is actually conducted is very different. So there are several factors. One is the fact that it's a one-time deal. You know, so if you are doing a simple cell culture experiment, so for example, what we had done for the ISS, if we had done that in the lab, we could have done it and found either didn't work or found some things that we could have done better, we just repeat it. And it's not a big deal to reculture the cells, plate them, and do it again. You can do it again, over and over again. Here, we have one shot. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work, or it gets contaminated, or something was wrong with the hardware, the design, basically all that work, time, money, resources is lost. So we're putting all our eggs in one basket, in a sense. So we have to really plan it well. The other issue is the hardware. Anytime you fly something in space, you can't just take, you know, the petri dishes and culture dishes that you just get out of a package that you order. This is, for the most part, custom designed and very expensive and complex. So even the simplest things, just having cells in a culture dish, that all you have to do is feed media is relatively complex. The other aspect is changes in flight, or even just before the experiment. We really can't change the experiment because it's set in stone, in essence, because the protocols, everything has been set up. So even leading up to the flight, once it's decided, you really can't change it. And definitely once you're in space, you can't change when you want to change the media or things like that, with some minor exceptions. But for the most part, everything has to be done with good planning. If something happened in a lab and we need to change the media in the middle of our experiment, we could easily do that normally. And the other issue is the limited resources, whether it be equipment that we would normally have in a lab, or availability of astronaut time. And crew time is a big issue. And we're very fortunate with this being a CASES project that we had some priority in terms of crew availability, but that's not always the case. And even then, we have to really work closely in terms of how much time we can get for the astronaut. In this case, Kate Rubins, we're really fortunate to have her, and with her experience being the one taking care of our experiment. But we're not always that fortunate. Sometimes you have someone with no prior biomedical experience, they have to be trained to do some of these things. So there are certainly a lot of limitations. But with good planning, good implementation partners, and support, it can be done. But certainly it's not like doing something in your own lab.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you touched on this a little bit, Peter. We're biologists, and we needed a team of other expertise to actually help us implement our project to the International Space Station. So we know how to do the cell culture and the cell biology. But of course, it's a pretty complicated process to take your biological experiment and actually transport it to the station. And so science these days is a very collaborative effort. That's a fact. And so we actually had the great privilege of collaborating with a group of aerospace engineers from the University of Colorado, BioServ Space Technologies, and they actually helped us design a lot of these custom pieces of equipment, these fully enclosed six-well plates in which we could grow our heart cells and actually transport these cells to the space station where they could be, changed, the media could be changed by Kate. So it was really a team effort, and we were really fortunate to have a team of people like BioServ to help us out.
So if you will just think with me for a moment, instead of growing cells like in a petri dish or in a flask, that wouldn't work in microgravity because the fluid would climb all over the walls of the flask. It wouldn't stay in contact necessarily with the cells. So this hardware that both Arun and Peter are mentioning is very unique in that it allows the cells to adhere to one side, be covered so that the fluid doesn't leave the container, and that covering had to also be gas permeable so that air could exchange with the media as well. And then it had to have a port on it so that the crew member, in this case Kate, could change the media and give the cells new food to eat. So that's just kind of a hint at how complicated it is and how much you have to think about when you're making an experiment for space. So, and let me back up to something that you said, Arun. You said just sending your cells to space, but you were actually at the launch, right? What does it feel like to have an experiment in your hand, hand it over to some folks that load it on a rocket, and then watch it leave the planet? What is that like?
I think from a scientific perspective, it's so unbelievably rewarding to see that something that you've worked on for 3 years it's leading up to this moment, this one launch. And we were all very fortunate in that our launch was very successful and everything went really well. So as a scientist, you want to be able to have access to these really unique environments such as microgravity so that you can do the coolest and most informative science. And we were really fortunate in that way. And from a personal perspective, I grew up wanting to be an astronaut as well. I think every little kid wants to be an astronaut at some point. And so to be there at the launch and to witness that in person was just absolutely incredible. We actually were part of a SpaceX launch where SpaceX was testing out a reusable rocket. And that was also really cool to experience as well, because about 20 minutes after the launch, the capsule separated, the capsule containing our experiment. It went off to the space station, and that contained our experiment. But the rest of the rocket was actually able to come back and land successfully upright on the launch pad. And if you know anything about aerospace engineering or rocket science or anything like that, you should realize that that's an incredible accomplishment. And just to be a part of something like that was really special.
Exciting, definitely very cool. So let me ask you, how connected did you feel to your experiment? I know once you did a lot of prior preparation and planning and a lot of thinking into the possibilities of what could go wrong and how to deal with issues that are occurring on orbit. But did you feel pretty connected to your experiment? Did you feel like you were getting, you know, information and updates and were you able to watch your experiment happen live?
Yeah, absolutely. For my perspective, where I've had other experiments that go up, this was night and day in terms of how connected I felt. My first experiment was back on John Glenn's flight on STS-95, and it was a small experiment. I was still a grad student at the time, and basically handed it over, and then they sent it to me by FedEx, you know, a few weeks later, and that was about it. So I didn't really feel connected at all, other than, you know, I got to see the launch and all of that. The last one was with fruit flies, and same deal. Essentially, the fruit flies were all in a self-contained system, and handed it over. It went up. There was nothing that happened in flight in real time, no immediate feedback, and then it came back. This was very different in that not only, again, having Kate Rubins be part of this and feeding the cells on a weekly basis, she also imaged the cells. So we got to see the actual cells essentially near real time in terms of how they were doing. There was immediate feedback in terms of how they looked and any suggestions that we might have. So having all of that has been a very different experience and really did feel connected, you know, as much as you can be, given that your cells are 250 miles away.
And we see you back with us, Kate. Fire alarm must be over. So you launched on July 6th, and then just about 2 weeks later, we had this SpaceX launch in which the heart cells were delivered via the Dragon capsule. Now, of course, there was thousands of pounds of equipment and supplies to the space station. You, Kate, were still kind of getting used to living in microgravity. Did it make you feel a little more at home when you got to pull out a microscope and use a glove box and do cell culture? Did that make you feel like, okay, now I'm doing science in space?
Absolutely. The Dragon launched, and one of the first few things we end up pulling off there is any science experiments that need to be kept at a particular temperature. So my crewmates laughed a little bit at me because I was saying, where are my cells? we need to get those going today. And it's actually, it's quite fascinating that we are able to do long-term cell culture in orbit now. So this is really a capability of the space station that we can launch cells, that they are orbiting the planet at Mach 25, and we can study the effects of free fall on cell culture. So cells are going to behave differently in free fall. It was fascinating being a human being in free fall inside the space station. You're falling all the time. And so that was actually a big objective of mine, was to try to understand how we can do science processing like you would in a normal laboratory, except for you're pulling it off of a spacecraft that's just launched off the planet, and we're doing it in this orbiting laboratory instead.
That's awesome. And for each of you on the panel, and Kate, you included, we've all talked a little bit, or we've hinted about how magical microgravity is. Can you tell us, you know, what is different for cell culture in microgravity? What might cells do, or how might they behave that is different than doing cell culture just on a plate or a flask on Earth?
Sure. I guess on the simplest level, and I think it's something that we touched on, you don't have to worry about, on the planet, you don't have to worry about the nutrients and all those different components going all over the place, right? So that's one, you know, thing that you just don't have to worry about, but that's a very realistic possibility in microgravity. And of course, just this is a very, very unique environment. It's something that's not very easily accessible to us here on Earth. And we don't really know too much about how individual cells perform in the context of microgravity. And I think that's why this particular experiment was so important.
Yeah, and we talked about, you know, just the practicalities of simple thing like changing media that you can change. You can train a high school student to do in a short matter of time. You just take out the fluid and put it back in. That becomes a much more complex process. So those are practical limitations. But as Arun had mentioned, you know, a lot of these cells, for example, these heart cells, as far as I know, is the first time heart cells have ever been flown in space. So we don't know what to expect. We didn't know if they were going to last this long in microgravity, even though our ground tests show that they would last a couple of months. We didn't know if that would be the same once they're in space. So, you know, to a certain degree, we have to take a chance and make our best educated guess. And so that's one of the limitations with doing any kind of microbiology research in flight.
Yeah, and I was particularly interested in how the cells were going to aggregate. When you plate cells on Earth, of course, they will often settle to the bottom of the dish and they will stick to each other, but they'll also stick to the plastic in the dish and form in certain ways. And one of the things that was really interesting to see was the structures that the cells formed as they aggregated together. And that is not disrupted by fluid flow like you would get if you have a rotating vessel to have cells constantly free floating. So it allows you to look at cellular interactions without that force of gravity, which is the physicists would disagree, but coming back to the planet, I'll tell you, gravity is a very strong force. So it constantly has an effect on the cells. And to me, it was very interesting to be able to do an experiment essentially in a place where the laws of physics seem to have changed, where we did not have that constant vector of gravity pushing the cells down onto the plate.
Did you have a follow-up?
Yeah, so, you know, and we've been talking a lot about the limitations and difficulties of doing spaceflight experiments because in the microgravity environment, but one thing that came to my attention, I was thinking about as Kate was talking about the gravity and how the cells are pulled down, and in some ways that could actually be helpful, for example, with tissue engineering. And that's one of the things that, you know, cases and with the US lab that they're trying to take advantage of this environment for applications for research. So tissue engineering is a field where the lack of this vector of gravity may actually be helpful. And I think there are ways we can take advantage of this environment to have these, to take advantage of these possible applications.
Absolutely. The tissue engineering, we have a tissue on chip challenge as well, and using microgravity as a tool to unlock, you know, investigations and unlock the secrets of many biological systems that we just can't do on Earth. So that brings me to my next question, Kate. You worked on well over 200 experiments. Heart cells wasn't the only thing that you got to work on. Talk to us about the space station as a research laboratory for other biological sciences, and what other facilities exist that allow you to do life sciences research in microgravity.
Yeah, so one of the parts of this experiment that wasn't just about looking at cardiomyocytes was really proving that we can do culture long-term. And that has application for a variety of different cell types. You know, just for example, fibroblasts would sit down and have some interaction with the plate. So there's a variety of structural things about the cell, what happens to structural proteins inside the cell. Everything in microgravity balls up. Everything wants to form spheres in fluids. And so we also look at what happens to fluid dynamics, processes like convection change. And then, of course, one of the things I was very interested in was a lot of the molecular work on space station. So we started the very first experiment to do DNA sequencing in space, and that was also a technology proof of concept, but it's very interesting to be able to get real-time analysis back from your experiment. So you could take a sample, for example, of the microbiome of the space station, which is a separate microbiome from Earth, and rapidly assess what's going on in the microbiome, or you could take a sample from one of the rodents that we have in rodent facilities up there and understand what's happening with bone loss in real time. So there's sequencing capabilities. There's now a couple different ways to do real-time PCR capabilities. So it's essentially a full-up cellular molecular lab. We have microscopy and fluorescence microscopy through our Japanese counterparts. And so one of the things that was very interesting is to look at this and try to think how we can do some end-to-end experiments where we are taking human samples or cell culture samples, we're growing them up, we're analyzing them, and then we're using molecular tools to get real-time analysis off the planet.
Fantastic. Got a little echo there. So we've touched a little bit on the fact that you got your cells back from the SpaceX capsule. Do you have any preliminary results that you'd like to share with us?
So we're still in the process of doing a lot of our downstream data analysis. A few things that we can share is that in general, on the broadest level, these cardiomyocytes, we believe, are a really good model system to be able to study microgravity. And that's because before the space flight, they were contracting, and during the space flight, they continued to contract, and there's a sample of cells that we still have back at our laboratory that is continuing to contract. And so at least on that level, you know, this does seem to be like a good model system. In terms of that contraction, there were some changes that occurred in response to microgravity, but we actually also observed that those changes in contraction that occurred reverted back to normal. For the most part, when these cells were turned back to planet side. And in terms of our gene expression analysis, that's still something that we're actively doing right now back in the lab.
And that highlights one of the capabilities that have been afforded to us is the fact that we can bring some of these cells back live. Mm-hmm. So fixing some in space, it kind of fixes it in time in terms of how the genes were expressing in space, but then be able to bring them back, continue to analyze them and see how they change or potentially revert back. That's a capability that is not always or has not always been possible in the past. And so with the Dragon capsule and our ability to retrieve our samples is also a great improvement in terms of our capabilities.
So next steps then, would you want to send additional cells back to the space station, or what is next in your analytics? Then you're going to get to the gene expression, seeing that the cells actually responded differently to microgravity and the way they were contracting, and then reverted back to normal when they returned to Earth is really pretty fascinating. I'm fairly certain that probably something similar happened to Kate's heart. It acted a little bit differently in microgravity. Now that she's back on Earth, she's technically still in her reconditioning phase, getting used to being back on Earth. And as Kate, as you mentioned, being in the gravity well is you can definitely tell you're back in gravity. But what would be the next step for your research?
The reason we like to do cell culture-based research is that it affords us a lot of control over the environment, as opposed to doing in vivo or animal research, where there's a lot of variables that affect the cells that you're interested in. So if we're looking at the heart, there are hormones and there are cytokines and there are a lot of factors and neurological input that affect the heart that we don't know if it's something that's direct at the tissue or some of these other factors. So we can isolate things in a cell culture. But cell culture is not the same as being in a whole heart either. And so I think once we get the data back, and especially with the gene expression studies, that'll help us focus in on certain genes and certain genes that may be a target for therapeutics, for example. So those would be interesting experiments that we could follow up with in terms both in cell culture, but ideally to take it to the next level, which would be a three-dimensional tissue culture model. And that's something that I have been interested in, and there are grant opportunities that we're looking at where we would do something very similar, but instead of looking at it in a two-dimensional culture, it would be a three-dimensional tissue that's beating, that'd be a little bit more like heart tissue. And then following up on that would be to maybe do something in an animal, for example, now that we've narrowed down the areas that we want to look at. But obviously there are a lot of steps in between to get to that point.
Yeah, and I think these sort of studies are, of course, not only limited to the heart. There are other investigators who are also interested in looking at liver cells and all the other organs of the body to see how their individual cells respond to microgravity. I think there's a lot of interest in seeing at the cellular level what's the effect of this really unique environment on human physiology.
Absolutely, and this is just the perfect time to be doing this type of research on the International Space Station. It's so capable. We've mentioned that there's freezers, you can fix tissues, there's microscopes, glove boxes, incubators for doing cell culture. So it's a wonderful time to be doing research on the space station. So Kate, when you do assumedly go back to the space station, what other types of experiments would you want to do in space? What did you not get done while you were in the space station?
Well, we got a lot done, but as I usually say when people ask what kinds of experiments you want to do, I just say all of them. I think some of the most interesting experiments coming up are ones that are investigating gravity as a tool in basic biology. So we talk a lot about how we're going to look at cells in microgravity for astronaut health, but it's also just a fundamental mechanism that we haven't been able to probe before. And so when you're studying the basic biology of a cell, for example, how cells interact, we now have a new variable to play with. And so we can remove gravity and as was mentioned, look at three-dimensional models of cell interaction. Does that change how the cells are communicating with each other, how they're associating with each other in tissue? Does it change our understanding of cellular signaling and of cell structure and function? And I'm quite interested in some of the molecular work because with some of the high throughput sequencing for broad analysis as well as real-time PCR for some focused analysis, we can look at a variety of tissues everywhere from microbial effects in space station to effects of radiation on DNA. We have a very interesting low Earth radiation environment that we cannot simulate right now on the ground. We can put cells into a beam that will do a single ion, but we can't simulate the complex mix of heavy ions. And so just being able to expose cells to that is really going to lead to advances, I think, in our understanding of cellular and molecular biology. So I go back up to the space station tomorrow and have quite a lot to work on. But I think one of the really interesting things is for scientists to try to figure out could either radiation or the lack of gravity be a factor in their experiment and design some experiments that are going to probe this really unique place that we have to study this that now has the combination of a lot of tools that you would find in a regular laboratory that's not going along at 17,500 miles an hour.
Fantastic. That's exciting. Actually, I have a question for this entire audience. Including you, Peter, and Arun, by raise of hands, who here wants to go doing science on the space station? This sounds like the best possible place to go. Yeah, pretty much everyone raised their hand, Kate. Before we wrap up, I want to ask, because Peter and Arun, you probably haven't had a chance to even speak with Kate yet about your research. Are there any questions that you've been dying to ask her that you haven't been able to yet?
Well, first I want to thank you, Kate, for taking such good care of our experiment and our cells. We're very fortunate in that there were no real major issues or complications, and we got our cells back, and hopefully we'll have all really good data. But I imagine not all experiments had gone perfectly, as I know from past experience and from other investigators I've talked to. As a scientist who have done hundreds of experiments on Earth, what is the biggest limitation or frustration in terms of what you're able, not able to do carrying out these other experiments? And are there any particular things that you wish you could have had or that potentially could try and fix or improve for future investigators?
Yeah, one of the most difficult things on board is getting enough time to do all of these investigations. The space station is an international laboratory, and we have countries from all over the world that want to fly their science. And so I think one of the things that we can actually work on moving forward in the future is multiplexing science on board the space station. So running a process like you know, a sequencer reaction or a PCR reaction, where we're actually running, or something as simple as pipetting, where we, rather than doing one sample at a time for one investigator, we're actually doing 96 samples or 384 samples. We've now proven a lot of the technology that allows us to do these kinds of lab experiments in low Earth orbit, which is quite surprising that they even are going to work, because there are things like microbubble formation that we don't have to deal with on the ground. But we have proven that almost all of these capabilities work. And so now the question is, can we actually turn this into a really high throughput laboratory where it's a bit more of a core facility type concept, and we are able to run hundreds of PIs experiments at the same time? And that's going to take some expansion of our sampling techniques, how we pull samples out from our animal models on board space station, how we take human samples, getting more accessible samples, as well as ways to understand how we might multiplex science and do 10 or 100 or 1,000 more experiments in that same limited crew time that you have on board.
So once again, Kate, I just wanted to say thank you so much for helping us with our experiment and being such an integral part of our experiment. And I think it's really cool to see an astronaut who's also a biologist, because, you know, maybe one day I can follow in your footsteps as well. I had a question about the technical challenges of growing cardiomyocytes. You're, of course, a cell biologist in your other career, and you've grown a number of different cell types. Where would you say cardiomyocytes, these heart cells, rank in particular in terms of their difficulty of being cultured and, you know, that sort of thing?
Well, they actually were quite easy to care for, and there were two challenges that I was worried about. One was, are we going to get bubbles introduced to the cell culture media? On the ground, of course, if you have a bubble or two, it just floats to the top and pops and disappears, and you don't really see bubbles in suspension. But in microgravity, when everything is in free fall, you'll get bubbles that will stay in suspension in your solution because there's no gravitational vector to bring the fluid down and the bubbles up. So this is, a really interesting area to experiment with and to understand how that's affecting biology, but could be a technical issue. And so I was very glad to see that we got introduction of some small bubbles as we were changing the media, but that this wasn't something that prohibited us from growing cells. And the cells actually clumped together very nicely. They are communicating with each other. And when you're doing cell culture, you know, you're always dreading a big cell die-off or a contamination of some kind. And it was actually very similar to just setting up a hood, cleaning it off, and keeping the cells healthy and alive and uncontaminated for I would have to say this is a bold experiment, you guys. Like, I'm very impressed how long we were able to keep the cells alive, because in my lab we used to grow cells for a much shorter duration and then infect them with a virus, and the experiment was usually done in about 48 hours. So the long-term cell culture was an interesting challenge, but it worked incredibly well on board.
And I want to thank all of our panelists for joining us today. I hope that you have a better appreciation for the challenges, but the unique aspects that of microgravity that the International Space Station affords us. Kate, again, did several hundred experiments while she was on board. Heart cells was, as she mentioned, a pretty bold and really, really cool experiment. We've had a great time during this panel, and I will remind you that later on today, we have another CASIS panel. It's called The Simulated Mission to ISS. It's in Ballroom A from 3:30 to 4:30, and that might also be a pretty cool experience to learn about doing science in space. And thank you very much. Appreciate everyone's time.